Welcome back to Bedtime Devos. I am your host, Mr. Jason. Thank you for joining me once again, and I'd love to see who showed up to view this week's installment. So, you can type the names of the kids watching in the comments below, and at the end, I'd love to read your answers to Pastor Kevin's Question from Kids segment. And for some announcements, we have Calvary Kids every Sunday morning at 9:30 and 11:15. Join Pastor Steve, Miss Steph, and Mr. Jeff as they take you through the entire Bible one week at a time. Next up, we have What You're Watching Right Now, premiering every Monday night at 7 p.m. Join me for Bedtime Devos as I try to help expand on the Bible lessons from Sunday mornings. On Wednesday nights at 7 p.m., it's Club Koinea. Join Pastor Steve and Mr. Jeff in the Summit Building for a lesson in God's Word with an extended game time and craft time with Ms. Carolyn. All December long, Club K will be focused on Pastor Steve's Christmas adventures, where each week will be a different lesson from the ones taught at Calvary Kids on Sunday mornings, and instead be focused on the real reason we celebrate Christmas. First things first, let's begin in prayer. Dear Lord, please help this fellowship be filled with your Spirit, Lord. Please help guide me through this lesson, so that way I can help the children watching and their parents get to know more about your word, Lord, and become closer through it. Pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Now it's time for our Bible verse. I'll say the verse, then you can repeat after me. God is not a man that he might lie, or a son of man that he might change his mind. Does he speak and not act? Or promise and not fulfill? And that comes from Numbers 23:19. For this entire unit, I've been discussing the background for this Bible verse. But let me speak a little on what God is actually forcing Balaam to tell King Balak. God is telling the king of the small kingdom of Moab that he isn't a liar like earthly kings, or indecisive like their princes. God doesn't make announcements and not follow through, or make promises he doesn't intend to keep like earthly kings do to their subjects. He is the creator and king of all. His ways aren't the ways of humans. His ways aren't tainted by sin as ours are. So he can be trusted to be truly faithful where we humans can't be. Now, let's take a look at something a little different than we've done in the past few weeks. As we see in our Christ connection, God keeps his promises. He remembered his promise to send a rescuer, and he sent his son Jesus into the world as a baby. Jesus grew up and provided salvation for sinners, all of us, by dying on the cross and rising from the dead. Now, what does it mean that God remembered? Does God ever forget anything? In the Bible, when it says that God remembered, it doesn't mean that God had forgotten something. It means to bring someone or something to mind and then act on it. So when it says that God remembered Noah and his family out in the ocean, God wasn't just sitting back watching cartoons and then jumped up exclaiming, "OMG, Noah!" It means God brought to his mind and chose that moment to act according to his plan. So if you've been praying for something and you feel God has forgotten you, he hasn't. Be patient and know that he hasn't forgotten you. This just isn't the moment for him to act on your behalf according to his plan. Now, let's get loosened up a bit before we head into the main Bible story by listening and moving along to our Bible verse song with Ms. Faith. And now, since everyone's loose, let's get to this week's Bible story.
When sin entered the world after Adam and Eve rebelled, God made an important promise. God promised a rescuer would come from Eve's family. As years passed, God's people waited for him to keep his promise. God sometimes spoke to his people through prophets and prophetesses, men and women who received a message from God and then told it to the people. The prophet Isaiah shared a message about God's promise to send a rescuer. The rescuer would be called the Messiah, which means anointed one or chosen one. This is what Isaiah wrote. The people are living in darkness now, but they will see a great light. A light will shine on them. God will grow the nation and give the people joy. People will rejoice like they do at harvest time or after a war is won. This is how God will keep his promise. A child will be born for us, a son will be given to us, and the government will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. All these names tell us who Jesus is and the great things that he would do. Jesus was coming to earth to help people and to protect people. Jesus would be a king who cares about his people, and he would bring peace to the whole world. Isaiah also said, "His kingdom will be full of his power and peace. The kingdom will grow, and he will reign on the throne as the king. He will be a good, fair, and loving king who reigns forever." God keeps his promises. He remembered his promise to send a rescuer and sent his son Jesus into the world as a baby. Jesus grew up and provided salvation for sinners by dying on the cross and rising from the dead.
We We as Christians have this amazing blessing to be able to look back at the Messiah who came and brought us salvation for our sins, so we can once again be reunited in heaven with God. But did you know not everyone had that blessing? For 2,000 years or so, God's promise for the salvation of mankind had the descendants of Abraham looking forward to the coming of the Messiah. They had no idea who it would be, and generation after generation of people would only get a tiny little taste of new information about who he'd be from a prophet during their lifetime, if they were lucky. And that new information often caused the Israelites to have more questions than answers about who the Messiah would be and when he'd finally show up. We can see from Scripture that God's promise to bring Jesus into the world goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, when God cursed Satan, who had taken the form of a serpent, that a descendant of Eve would crush the head of the serpent. From Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 and 15, the Lord said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all the cattle, and more than any animal of the field. On your belly you shall go, and the dust you shall eat all of the days of your life. And I will put enmity, open hostility, between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall fatally bruise your head, and you shall only bruise his heel." There are 300 or so prophecies about the coming Messiah in the Old Testament, so I'm not really going to cover them all. But the next major one I would like to look at is Abraham taking Isaac up to Mount Moriah to sacrifice him. From Genesis chapter 22, verses 7 and 8, "And Isaac said to Abraham, 'My father.' And he said, 'Here I am, my son.' Isaac said, 'Look, the fire and the wood, but where's the lamb for the burnt offering?' Abraham said, 'My son, God will provide for himself a lamb for the burnt offering.' So the two walked on together." This is a lie on Abraham's part. God didn't tell him this. It seems as though Abraham was trying to keep an Isaac, who was growing increasingly suspicious of their journey up the mountain, from worrying or turning back. Or, as is the way of our Lord, maybe as I've been thinking recently, God had the Holy Spirit place this thought and these words into Abraham's mind. Remember, God had no intention of allowing Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, but he needed Abraham to think that the test was real. And it was indeed prophetic, as God did provide the perfect lamb in his son Jesus to be sacrificed. And many believe that the mountain that Jesus was crucified on was the same Mount Moriah that Isaac was to be sacrificed on. Next, let's skip to another foreshadowing of Christ's coming from Numbers chapter 21, verses 6 through 9. "Then the Lord sent fiery, burning serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and many Israelites died. So the people came to Moses and said, 'We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord so that he will remove the serpents from us.' So Moses prayed for the people. Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Make a fiery serpent of bronze and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten will live when he looks at it.' So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it on a pole. And it happened that if a serpent had bit any man, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived." Here we see the Israelites being given the chance to be saved from their sins simply by looking at the bronze serpent and believing in the power of the Lord to save them. Just as we now have salvation simply by accepting Jesus as our Lord and Savior, nothing more is needed. We should strive to do good works in his name. We should study the Word of God. But those aren't needed for salvation. Only giving your heart over to him in faith. Centuries after Moses, the prophet Isaiah would deliver the message of the coming Messiah in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. For to us a child shall be born, to us a son shall be given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There shall be no end to the increase of his government and of peace. He shall rule on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness. From that time forward and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Isaiah's prophecy helped to give more detail over the promise God made to King David that a descendant of his would rule over Jerusalem forever. Many prophets spoke of tiny little tidbits of information to give the coming generations of Israelites clues as to the identity of the Messiah when he finally arrived. Jeremiah gave a clue to his birth. Daniel told them he'd come to make an end of sin. Hosea foretold of Jesus' time in Egypt. Joel spoke to the Messiah's offer of salvation to all mankind, not just the Jewish people. Micah told of his birth in Bethlehem. We have all of this information gathered and can look at its completion. The Israelites had to take clues from prophets living at times centuries apart. They had created in their own minds what the Messiah should be like and what he should have been doing. So while our salvation lies in our faith of the Messiah who arrived, their salvation lied in their faith in the promise of God to send a Messiah, his anointed one. God made the promise to bring forth a Messiah before you were born, before I was born, before Jesus was born, before Daniel, before David, before Abraham, even before Noah, before Cain and Abel. A promise made back in the garden. A promise to one day bring us to a state where we can once again walk with him in all his glory as Adam and Eve did. And that's a promise I'd very much love to be a part of. How about you? That was so much. I think you all deserve a bonus song before we move on to questions from kids. Time to prep yourselves for the Pastor Kevin Shuffle. Ready? You set?
Hi there, I'm Pastor Kevin. It's time for questions from kids. Benjamin from New York, New York asks,
my dad promised to let me invite a friend over this weekend, but now he has to work. I'm really mad. What should I do?
Oh, Benjamin, that's a great question. As parents, we often find ourselves sometimes making promises that we shouldn't make to our children because we don't have absolute control over our schedule and over our lives. And so sometimes, because we love our children so much, we want to do certain things for them. And then our promises are broken and we can't be as faithful as we had planned to be. So what should you do? Benjamin, first, I think you should honor your mother and your father because the Bible tells us to honor our mother and our father. So you should be gracious to him and you should be loving and kind towards your dad and know that he really wants what is best for you. The second thing, Ian, I don't want you to sin in your anger. The Lord tells us that it's okay to be angry. It's just not okay to sin in our anger. Third, I would pray for an opportunity to have the friends over again and pray that your dad's work goes really, really well and that you all could spend more time together even after he gets off from work. Parents often want to be really, 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 really faithful, but the Lord, above all, is always faithful. His yes is always yes, and his promises will never be broken because he is more faithful than anyone else. You see, God remembered his promise. His promise was to send a rescuer, to send his son, Jesus Christ, into the world. And you know what? God was faithful in doing that because he is God. And so where adults and family members and friends often break their promises of faithfulness, God never breaks his promise of faithfulness. How do you feel knowing that God is always faithful?
So I want to hear from you in the comments section. How do you feel knowing that God is always faithful? I hope everyone had a great time tonight. Please continue to let me know what you think about the new format. And let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you once again for the blessing of allowing me to make these videos and come into the homes of the children and parents watching so that I can help teach them more about your word, Lord. Maybe from a different perspective than they get to learn at Sunday school. I know you helped me look at things a little bit differently, Lord. And I thank you so much for the blessing of guiding me each week through these lessons. I hope everyone has a very blessed week. And I hope to see them again next week, Lord. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, blessings to everyone watching. And I hope to see you again next week. As we lift up the praise, set our tongues ablaze, as we raise our hands, give a praise unto the Lord. Stand up and sing, when we accept this offering.